call him, but now his second meeting with him at the Sea of Galilee, he calls them. And then you'll find they went back to fishing. Mark gives us that in detail, and also Luke. And you'll find that he called them again, and that was to apostleship. That's the wonder of it all, that he called men like this. And I've always felt if he called men like these men, he may be able to use me, and he may be able to use you. How wonderful it is to know he doesn't call perfect men. Now he saith unto them, follow me, I'll make you fishers of men. I may not make you a fisher of man because you're not a fisher. You're not in the fishing business. Maybe you're in some other business, but he'll use you. And whatever your talent might be, if you turn it over to him, he could use. I used to tell a lady that was a member of my church years ago, she could bake the most wonderful cakes in the world, but she is tongue-tied when it came to talking to anybody. And she used to deplore the fact. And I said, never heard of you. Maybe the Lord wants you in church to cook cakes. Somebody says, well, that's ridiculous. No, it's not, friend. Whatever your talent is, God can use it if you let him use it. That's the important thing. And I don't care whether you got a talent or not, he can use it. And he won't have us all doing the same thing because we all don't have the same gift. The body of Christ has many members in it, and they're not all the same members. Now we know this, and they straightway left their nets and followed him. And going on from thence, he saw two other brethren, James the son of Zebedee and John his brother, in a ship with Zebedee, their father, mending their nets, and he called them. I'm not going to deal with these men, but in the other Gospels, you're going to get a little better acquainted with them, by the way. Very interesting man. And they immediately left the ship from their father, and they followed him. And Jesus went about all Galilee, now this is in the north section now, teaching in their synagogue. He's teaching and preaching the gospel of the kingdom. What is it? It's at hand in the person of the king. They are to accept and receive him, and healing all manner of sickness and all manner of disease among the people. Literally, friends, there were thousands of people in that day that Jesus healed. Are we going to see Matthew specializes in letting you know that? And if we'll pay attention to it, we'll find out that we're just a few isolated cases. Thousands of people. That's the reason they never question his miracles. Too many of them walking around. By the way, I live in Southern California. I don't see many of these so-called miracles walking around. They don't seem to come my way. Verse 24, and his fame went throughout all Syria, and they brought unto him all sick people that were taken with divers diseases and torments, and those which were possessed with demons, and those which were lunatics, and those that had the palsy, and he healed them. Notice the multitude, and there followed him great multitudes of people from Galilee, from the Decapolis, the 10 cities on the east side of the Jordan River, and from Jerusalem. Now they came up from Jerusalem, and from Judea, and from beyond Jordan. That means a long ways off. He is ministering there in the north. Now we find in the next three chapters, Matthew 5, 6, and 7, we've come to the first major discourse that Matthew records. He records three major discourses. The Sermon on the Mount, and then in Matthew 13, the Mystery Parable discourse, and then in Matthew 24 and 25, the Olivet discourse. The Sermon on the Mount is the manifesto of the king, and the Mystery Parable discourse gives the direction the kingdom of heaven will take after his rejection, and then the Olivet discourse is the
say.